the blackness. Keep on.
Amen and amen. Thank you for starting our worship service off great this morning. We begin today in our study of the book of Romans. In Romans chapter 1, verse 1, hear these words. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his son, who as to his human nature was a descendant of David, and through the spirit of holiness was declared with power to be the Son of God by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and for his name's sake, we received grace and apostleship to call people from among the Gentiles to obedience that comes from faith. And you also are among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all in Rome who are loved by God are called to, and called to be saints, grace, peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. So again, today we begin the study on the Pauline letter to the Roman church. And as we begin the study of this powerful book, know again that we will only get out of this study what we are willing to put in. So with that, I'm asking, this is my ask to maximize our comprehension during this time, is number one, download the Bible study and answer the questions. Number two, read the commentary associated with each week's lesson. And number three, read the entire 16 chapters included in this letter once a month for the next 6 months, 5 to 6 months we're studying this book. With that, I believe that our comprehension, ingestion, and digestion will be at its peak. Now, what is this letter, Romans? No one would be more surprised that his letters would become part of our canon called our Bible than Paul. If we look at his letters to the churches, they were all written in response to letters that were written to Paul about issues that has arisen after he had started these churches. Therefore, the letter to the Corinthians were responses. The letter to the church in Philippi was a response. The church in Thessalonica, this was a response. And Paul was just being a good and responsible pastor to these churches. But this letter to the Roman church was different in its purpose and in its composition. Many of you listening today are old enough to remember what a mixtape was. But a mixtape was to this generation like the top songs on your playlist, okay? But in the construction of a mixtape, what I would do as a DJ, I would take a blank tape and I would take the recorded music of all of my favorite songs and I put on this tape. And let me tell you, a good mixtape was valuable because I could make copies, I could sell it, a lot of people wanted access to this mixtape. And in that same vein, this letter to the Roman church was Paul's mixtape. Why? Because it was not in response to a problem, because he's never been there before. So what was Paul's effort with this letter was to put everything into this letter that would be needed to extend Christianity westward. And what better way to do that was to send it to Rome, which was the capital of the world at that time. This is why the book of Romans is called the foundation of the Christian faith, because there are pieces of Corinthians and Thessalonians and Philippians and Ephesians and more. This letter to the Roman church had to be a complete work that could stand by itself, because he's not going to be there to deliver the message himself. So last week I made a statement that said, when people ask me regarding, you know, Pastor, where do I start in reading the Bible? And immediately I would instruct them to go to the Sermon on the Mount, where we spent the last 6 months and 27 sermons studying. But the next place I would tell them to go after the Sermon on the Mount is Romans, the foundation of the Christian faith. And that's where we will spend the next 6 months studying. So Romans is Paul's mixtape. So let me say his masterpiece. And Romans is actually the clearest and fullest explanation of the gospel in the entire Bible. The book of Romans is a masterfully written exposition on the grace of God. What it means, how we respond to this grace, how we receive this grace, and how we extend it to others. As we set the tone for this study, it is important to keep the audience in mind. Remember, this letter is written to believers, written to those who have accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. This is the primary audience. But does that mean that others can't be saved through our study over the next 6 months? It does not mean that at all. My expectation that some will hear these messages, some will engage conversations with you and be saved as a result of this study. But the reception of the fullness of this study will not be received by the unbeliever. More context. Paul was in the city of Corinth when he wrote Romans, and Paul couldn't just go down to the local office supply and get a couple of reams of paper and pen this letter. Paper, parchment paper, that during this time was very expensive, very hard to come by. Why is that important to our study? Because writing back then didn't give the liberty to just write just to be writing. This was not a recreational exposition. So all of the words were important. They had meaning. There was no time to beat around the bush. We had to get right to the point. With this in mind, this first verse of the letter tells us a lot as we will dissect it. This first verse covers Paul's introduction to the book of Romans, as well as building a case for the entire world that we are guilty before God. Guilty before God. You're going to hear that theme a lot throughout this study on Romans. Guilty before God. So the reason for writing this book of Romans was to share the gospel and to teach that our righteousness, our salvation, comes by faith in Jesus Christ, apart from anything we can do to earn it. So it is a letter that flies in opposition to the works righteousness theology, that we can earn our way to heaven or we can add to our salvation. So I offer you a thought to frame this first sermon as we begin this study. God can use you. God can use you. Service to the Lord is something that seems to be a struggle for many. And the reasons range all the way from the busyness of life and laziness, maybe not thinking we're as gifted to serve, in some form or fashion, but the number one reason why many Christians shy away from service is, I've been told, guilt over their past sins. Many feel that they've done so much wrong and so much sin in the world, by the time they give their life to the Lord, they're useless. There's nothing that they can do because they have just sinned their way out of service and being used by God. As we start this series on Romans, let me underscore when it comes to serving the Lord. Time is not the issue. Because people do what they want to do and make excuses for what they don't want to do. Talent is not the issue. We are gifted before we are ever saved to do everything the Lord is requiring us to do for kingdom building. So then we brought up the fact that sins of our past, that's problematic, and we'll touch on that later. There's no doubt that is an issue, but is not an insurmountable hurdle. But what actually keeps us from serving effectively and being greatly used by God is we have a heart condition. It's our heart. I heard a quote that says, the true measure of a man is his heart. And the level to which we give our heart to anything is noticed by others. You will see someone who is passionate about something, and it'll come out in the tone, in their voice, in the context, the content and continuance of their conversation, whether they're talking about a person or something, and they may have on clothes to represent the passion so that others will know they have a heart for what they are championing. They are all in for a particular sports team. They're all in for a particular hobby. Even this idea is even translated to relationships. Others will be able to know or detect or discern if we are all in for our spouses, all in for our children, all in for our family members and friends. So in that vein, our commitment, continuance, and passion about serving God will be in the measure, it will be measured in our heart. And it's hopeful that every day we look to sacrifice more of our heart to God, and that we will be known as one who is all in for God, passionate about God, that we are true representatives of the God who saved us. I'm here to tell you this morning, God can and God wants to use you. And the Apostle Paul seeks to shed light on this service barrier today. Today, Paul seeks to use this introduction to show what a heart for God looks like. And all of us have the capacity to have a sold out heart for God. First of all, Paul tells us that he is a servant. And this seems, when I read this for the first time, it seems simple enough. However, our English language fails us at times when we are reading scripture. To bring out the depths and the gravity of what Paul was saying in what he was regarding himself when he used the word servant. The word Paul used here that's translated servant in a Greek word is pronounced doulos. This word doulos is also translated bond servant or slave. You see, in the Roman world, they knew quite well what it meant to be a slave. Out of the 120 million people that were in Rome, 60 million of them were slaves. And of the six Greek words Paul could have used, he used doulos, which represented the lowest slave. A doulos slave was one who was totally controlled by his master. He was usually bought in the slave market and was bought as a captive from an enemy nation. The inference here is that Paul is saying not only he, but we should understand ourselves as slaves of Christ as well. Because it was Christ's blood that purchased us from being held captive in our sin, Egypt. And through this purchase, we belong to Jesus completely in a relationship where we are under total control of our master, Jesus. That sounds simple enough. But I didn't get this. I didn't. It was a terrible barrier for me, because I struggled with this reality of what Paul is saying about our relationship with Jesus. Why? Because I was trying to view this relationship with Jesus through the lens of American slavery because of the master-slave nomenclature. There have been slaves, and slavery has existed since the beginning of civilization. But not until American slavery, where slaves were considered subhuman, where slave masters were brutal in their care, separating families, murdering, raping, castrating slaves. The relationship between a slave and their master during American slavery was one of resentment, not one of respect. It was contentious. It wasn't compassionate. And every moment, either thought of trying to escape as a slave or working or hoping for a life, a better life that did not include the slave master. So forced submission characterized this relationship. And this is why, for me, as an African-American man, I struggled with the thought process of Jesus being my master and I'm his slave. My relationship with Jesus started off suspicious and not with submission, until I was able to separate the two and say, you know, Jesus, I'm not going to make you pay for what someone else messed up because of their sin and greed. You are far greater than Master Tom, who killed my father, raped my mother, and sold my sister. Jesus, you are a master who gave his life for the slaves who serve him. You are a master who strengthens families. You don't break them up. You're a master who considers me as precious, as created just a little lower than the angels, not three-fifths of a human or not human at all. So I had to work through this reality so that I can come to a realization that for this master-slave relationship with Jesus, there is safety in submission. Safety in submission. And this is why many of us have a heart issue with Jesus, because these terms, master, slave, submission, they trigger images in our minds, what we read and saw and even experienced, that are problematic, and we won't know part of it at all. But I'm going to give you an insight onto how I came to work through all of this noise and pain, and to not only be comfortable, but willing to be totally committed and submitted to Jesus. So the idea that Paul is presenting here is not just an idea of slave master property ownership, but this type of doulos bond between master slave, it's about primarily relationship. If we only understand our bond with Jesus as servant master property ownership, we will begin to resent his authority in our life, the same way sometimes people do at their jobs as it relates to their bosses or supervisors, and service in response to this type of relationship It too oftentimes it's forced or coerced, and generally we're not giving our best in an atmosphere of coercion. That's why Jesus says, I'm not going to force you to follow me. I'm not going to force you to serve me. The reason why some Christians are more submissive to the lordship of Christ is the understanding of this bond relationship. Therefore, they can love Jesus more. Huh. See, a Jewish slave could only be held for 7 years. And the seventh year, he was set free. However, if this slave wanted to stay with the family voluntarily, he would have his ear pierced, identifying him with a particular family until his death. He would be a slave for a lifetime. And Paul is speaking of himself as a lifetime slave of Jesus Christ. His heart had been pierced and captured by the love Christ had for him. 2 Corinthians 5 and 14 says it like this. It says, for the love of Christ constrains me. We know what a constraint is, right? It's a device that holds someone or something. Paul was a slave of Christ, constrained by his love for Jesus Christ in response to Jesus' love for him. Aha. Now it makes sense. In order to be more committed, in order to be more submissive, we need to love Christ more. So it's not about my talent or lack thereof. Everything is predicated that I do and respond to in how much I love the Lord. It's the heart condition that fixes all other problems. And in order to love Christ more, for me, it was important to realize all of what Christ did for me. He forgave me of my sin. He took the penalty of punishment for the sin he forgave me of. That's the death on the cross. He gave me the gift of his Holy Spirit, and now I have the privilege of called service to the Lord, which means my retirement program puts me in heaven. But everything points back to the depth of our relationship with Christ. And if we're not serving effectively, if we're not giving sacrificially, if we're not able to work with others in the ministry, it all points back to our heart condition and our understanding of this doulos relationship with Jesus Christ. With a heart for Christ, you know what? I can't wait to serve. With a heart for Christ, I can't wait to sacrificially give. I allow the Holy Spirit to give me the patience to work with others. Now, during this sermon series, I'm going to have some things called quarantine thoughts. Thoughts that I want you to think about over and over as we this time that we're apart until we get back to in-person service. So, quarantine thought. Do I work well with other believers? And what can I do to improve working relationships when we return to in-person service? That's a question that I want you to ask yourself over and over again as we prepare to be better for the body than when we stopped in March. You see, from the pastor's seat, we all got room to work in this area, even me. Amen. Back to verse 1. Paul also spoke about being called by Jesus Christ. Paul was literally spoken to by Jesus Christ. On the day Christ saved him, he was going to Damascus to arrest Christians, and Jesus appeared to him in a bright light and revealed himself to Paul. Paul immediately accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. This is what Jesus says to him in Acts 26, verse 16 and 17. I have appeared to you to appoint you as a servant and as a witness of what you have seen of me and what I will show you. I will rescue you from your own people and from the Gentiles. I am sending you to them. Paul did not receive his job from somebody, from a man. He did not appoint himself to a position. God chose his job. This word apostle means someone who is sent out with a specific mission. Paul's mission was to be one of men chosen to be the start of the New Testament church. Paul had a specific mission to be an apostle to the Gentiles, though the acceptance of his call, the gospel spread through Europe and around the world. Every Christian has a job. Ours may not be as big as the Apostle Paul, but it's still important. Every Christian has a place in God's work. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not talking about generic and just hanging around and waiting to see if something comes up or whatever needs to be done. I'm talking about a specific responsibility that God has called you to do. The Bible tells us that we all have that. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 14 and 18, it reminds us that every Christian is important to the church. For the body is not just one member, but many. But now God has set the members, every one of them in the body as he has pleased. God has handed out. This is your assignment, if you're willing to accept it. Paul was not man appointed. He was not self appointed. Jesus called him in the same way. Guess what? I didn't ask you to join this church. Jesus called you into membership of this body. You have been sent here because there was a need, there was a void that was open that God was going to use you to help fill it. There should be a wait list for opportunity to serve. However, we have vacancies all over the church, even before the pandemic hit. When I look at this past year of 2020, and how the unemployment lines continues to grow and people feverishly looking for work and even getting depressed with all of the talent in the world and even getting dressed up, still can't secure employment. And people are praying and shouting, Lord, just give me a job. Then I look at the church. Even before the pandemic hit, with help wanted signs all over the place, but no lines forming to do said work. God, we just called upon your name to give us secular jobs, but he called us to work in his ministry and in this kingdom. But Lord, we don't want to work until we find a job paying us a wage that we're comfortable with. And when we get that job, we say we still can't work in the ministry because of that job. And we praise God for that job to feed our families. But we continue to neglect the job that feeds us spiritually. Oh, when we return to in-person service. I have dreams and prayers that of us having a line forming to serve in the children's ministry such that we'd have to turn some people away. I have visions of a line forming just to try out for the choir. That there's just not even enough room for the ushers who are trying to serve in that capacity. Oh, if I had more help setting up and breaking down for fellowships and receptions in the fellowship hall. Oh, if we had a line to visit the sick, cook the food, and a host of other things that were going on and will continue to go on around here. Here's another quarantine thought for you. What line am I working, hoping, and preparing to stand when we return to in-person service. Yeah. Everyone has something that they're called to do and expected to do by God. And it's time for us all to get on our knees and pray and say, God, help me understand and develop my doulos relationship with Jesus. The body of Christ literally aches for your committed service. The body of Christ literally aches for your committed service. Paul then goes on to talk about being separated to the gospel. It seems unusual that Paul would mention his calling twice in the same verse. But if we let the Bible interpret itself, we will find that this separation to the gospel was not when Paul was saved or when he was called to be an apostle. The only other time Paul ever mentions himself as being separated was in Galatians 1, verse 15 and 16, where it says, "But when God, who set me apart from birth, called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal to his son in me, so that I may preach among the Gentiles, I did not consult any man." Paul's order of his commission was separated to the gospel at birth, saved on the road to Damascus, and called to be an apostle immediately following. What does that mean? It simply means that God knew Paul was going to be saved. God knew how he was going to use Paul in sharing the gospel and preaching the gospel and bringing the gospel to the Gentiles before he was even born. God orchestrated his life events to provide him with the tools to make him successful even before he was a follower of Jesus. What were some of Paul's tools he received? Well, first of all, Paul was a Jew. He learned under the greatest teacher of that time, Gamaliel, one of the greatest rabbis of Jewish history. He knew Judaism inside and out, and God used that knowledge to prove from the Jewish scriptures that Jesus was the Messiah that they were actually looking and waiting for and hoping for. Paul was a Roman. He grew up in Tarsus as a native-born Roman with all of the perks and clout of being a Roman citizen. He used his clout as he traveled in his mission trips to enter places otherwise would be closed, even to protect him at times in hostile environments. Paul was from Greece. Tarsus was a Greek city, seat of a well-known university. Paul probably received an outstanding Greek and pagan education. Paul was a highly educated man, and he knew the Greek culture and history. Paul was used by God. You know, God used Paul's pre-salvation experiences, good and bad, in ministry. Now think about that. Whatever talents and abilities and experiences and education or gifts you've picked up along the way, God can use them. God wants to use them if we allow him to. People ask me all the time, they say, "Pastor, do you miss engineering? Do you miss project management?" I said, "Not at all." I tell them that I do more of that work now serving the Lord than I ever did in the secular world. And as I look back on my life, there were no wasted moments. And God is using all of these different experiences, good and bad, at different times, and allows me to minister and build the kingdom. Nothing's wasted. Those things in our past that we are ashamed of, God is using them. Those things. Those things that we're good at, but we just don't see how can that actually be used in kingdom building. God used Moses' Egyptian education, his work as a shepherd, his staff in leading Israel out of bondage. God used David's occupation as a shepherd, his talent as a musician and a hunter, and even his sling and harp as he progressed to become king of Israel. I know we sometimes look at our usefulness in the kingdom based on how someone else is being used. And I'm just going to plead with you this morning. Stop doing that. Don't think that I can't be used because I don't sing that well. I don't pray that well. I don't even look like that. So stop limiting God's use of you based on how he's using someone else. I'm going to use this for an example or an analogy, if you would. I recently had foot surgery. And I had some things going on with my right big toe. And they went in surgery, and I'm still recovering from it now. But let me tell you, in this recovery, I have a whole new respect for my big toe. Because when it was not working, or working properly, or there's pain, it infects my whole body. It undermines my ability at time to speak. Toe pain will silence every word coming out of your mouth, Jesus. It doesn't matter how strong my legs are if my toe isn't working properly. They're useless. And guess what? The big toe, it doesn't get much press. It's not seen a lot, and most of the time is stuffed in a sock, housed in a shoe. But when that toe is functioning properly, when it's doing its job effectively, the body can run, the body can jump. When the body is really functioning effectively, we don't even realize the toe is there. Someone once told me, you know what? My capacity in this company is service. I am support, and this is where I'm most effective. I'm not the face of the franchise. This is what I am called to do. If I become the focus, then I have failed in doing my job effectively, because the company is not at its best when I am the focus. Now listen, sometimes, especially in the church, we got too many toes trying to be fingers. Therefore, the body can't walk or run. And just because we may have figured out how to write with our feet, that's not what our feet were created to do. And in this body of Christ called Third Presbyterian Church, we need some serious discernment during this quarantine time. I call it, we need to get and have a big toe mentality, a big toe mentality. And to say to ourselves, if I'm not working, then the body is going to be stagnant. If I'm causing a lot of pain, the body is going to be limping. If I'm trying to be a thumb, then the body is going to be stagnant. If I just want attention being brought to me, the body can't be effective. In having a big toe mentality, I want you to remember this. God is not going to give you a pedicure if all you can do is be petty. God is not going to give you a pedicure if you just keep being petty. It doesn't matter what our talent level is. What matters is whether these are given back to God to be greatly used by him as he chooses to. In the early years, Paul uses education and zeal to oppose Christianity. And it was only after he had his dramatic encounter with Christ that he was able to use these important tools in a right way. Many of us are very gifted, but we're not using them in the right way. Therefore, the body can't be effective. God has purposed all of the experience, talents, abilities that we've gained. It is not useful. It's not useless. I'm sorry. God needs big toes, other toes, ankles, feet, hands, arms, legs, and a host of other body parts to make this body effective as we wage war against sin. We need all of these body parts as we wage war for lost souls, as we wage war against injustice, as we wage war on poverty, against senseless violence, and we wage war on domestic violence, war on economic disparity, waging war on the lack of health care. We wage war on child neglect. There is a war going all around us, and we're being given a chance right now during this quarantine time to prepare for battle in a way that we've never been able to prepare before. The war needs soldiers, not spectators. The army needs effort, not excuses. We need everyone, even the physically and emotionally handicapped, because in God's army, all of his soldiers can be made handicapable. Yeah. Constrained by love, motivated by the blood, serving God as a slave for life. God wants to use you. God can use you if you let him. I want to thank you and bless you this morning for worshiping and walking with us today. We're off to a fantastic start with this letter to the Roman church, and there's just so much more in store for us. Again, don't forget our weekly Bible studies on Tuesday and Thursday evening, virtual, and our virtual Sunday school at 8:30 every Sunday morning. There will be no children's ministry today. Right now, we're only doing the first three Sundays of the month. Hopefully, we'll be able to grow and have a greater commitment to offer that every Sunday of the year until we return. I want to thank you for allowing me to be your pastor. Thank you for allowing my wife and I to minister to you in the way that God has called us and is leading us. God bless you. God keep you. And let us conclude in song.
The blackness. Keep it, keep on.